Hi, welcome to our second Fireside Chat. My name is Leanne Ellis, and I'm from the Lucius Beebe Memorial Library in Wakefield, Massachusetts. And with me is the rest of the reference staff. I'm a reference and readers advisory librarian, and to my left is Jackie Powers, who does our PR, Jeff Klapes, who's the head of our reference department and adult services, Karen Stern, who is head of our programming, and also Beth Radcliffe, who is someone who takes care of our home delivery. We're all reference librarians, but what we also do is readers advisory. So there's many services we can provide for you. We do book kits, we do individual requests, and we will talk to you about books at any point, at any time when we're at the library, and even on the street. We're very willing to do that as well. So we're here to talk today about some books that made us take notice last year. Some of the list is topic-driven, some is by genre, and in my case, I do a couple of best-of lists. So what we're going to do is start with Jackie.
Thank you, Leanne. So, this is actually my first Fireside Chat. I did not do it last year, but I decided on a nonfiction theme, which is a little bit different, and I landed on this idea of sort of accessible social psychology. I called the list Perspectives. So think Malcolm Gladwell's Blink or David and Goliath, The Tipping Point, but with a little bit more of a personal angle. These books are about why humans, why we do what we do, and how little shifts in your either your perspective or your mindset or your attitude can have a big impact on your life. Many of the titles on my list started as TED Talks and sort of blossomed into full-length books. TED, of course, is the Technology Entertainment Design Media Nonprofit Organization, and their slogan is Ideas Worth Sharing, and I really think that these books are those. So you might see the titles and think, these look like self-help books, but I can assure you they're really not that. They're not so much instructional as informational. Mm-hmm. The authors, there's no kind of 12 steps to complete checklist type things. In most cases, the authors are really just presenting this information to you and saying, you do with it what you will. Take away from it what you can. I actually prefer to listen to a lot of these books during my commute, and we do own most of them on audio at the library. They're sort of thought-provoking without being heavy, and they combine enough science speak with anecdotes, and they're broken up into these nice little chunks. So for a 25-minute commute, it's a nice way to break it up. They're very readable and listenable. So the first title on my book is Angela Duckworth's Grit, and it's The Power of Passion and Perseverance. So she's a psychologist, a professor at the University of Pennsylvania, and she also won a MacArthur Fellowship, which is also known as the Genius Grant, which is funny because her father actually basically told her all her life she wasn't very smart. And so at her most basic, her work really talks about why people succeed. Why do some people succeed in one and some mm-hmm. fail? And how your intelligence is not really a guarantor of success. It's really more about identifying your passion and following through on your commitment, so perseverance. So she has this powerful story because she had this father who didn't really believe in her. And she has a sort of winding path, career path. She was a teacher, she was a consultant, and now she's basically a neuroscientist. And this sort of led her to that hypothesis that genius is not what drives success, but this sort of special blend of passion and perseverance. It's really a fascinating study, and her findings are really intriguing.
Do you have any tidbits you'd like to share with us about those findings?
Well, she did. One of the interesting parts was she studied West Point students. So these are the, you know, creme de la creme academically, physically. They're all highly qualified, but some fail, some drop out pretty quickly, and some stay in. And mm. she sort of looked at why, what was the difference? Mm. You know, there were some studies she did on that. She also said that it can take 2 years to really develop a passion for something, and that you shouldn't for hobbies and other interests. Career interest, you really need to give something 2 years before you decide that it's not for you. Anything less than that is not a fair chance. So really, no matter what your age or walk of life, if you have kids, if you don't have kids, there's something for everyone to take away from this book. It's a lot of practical applications. So again, that was Grit, The Power of Passion and Perseverance by Angela Duckworth. And now we are going to Jeffrey.
Thank you. I thought I'd try something a little bit different from what I've done in the past. So this year, I decided to talk about comfort reading. Comfort reading is something that a lot of people do in the winter, and I thought I'd try something unique in that I'm not dealing with adult books. I wanted to see what it was like to revisit books that you read as a child, often the kind that you might have read under the covers with a flashlight, you know, when you were a little kid.
Definitely.
To see if they resonate the same way as an adult. As adults, we have more wisdom, more life experience, less innocence, and sometimes reading those books that we remember from our childhood, some of them really still resonate the same way that they did, and others, they've lost something because you're a different person now. Now that you have more cares and responsibilities, and they just don't feel the same way. So I wanted to look at some of those. Many of the authors on my list are people who write for adults as well as children, and so you'll often see that maturity in their writing, that whether they're writing for one audience or another, they still have very, very pithy writing styles. So the first one I wanted to talk about was Madeline L'Engle's Wrinkle in Time, mm-hmm. which I think most people have heard of, at least, even if they never actually read it as a child. It was first published in 1963, and it won the Newbery Award for Children's Literature, which is sort of the prestigious children's lit award, and it's still considered a science fiction classic today, and kids still read it all the time. It's one interesting tidbit about it is that it's one of the few books that actually begins in an ironic fashion with the phrase, "It was a dark and stormy night," which is kind of fun. So the plot focuses on 13-year-old Margaret Murray, who is a very bright, kind of misunderstood kid. And she feels kind of underappreciated by her family and overshadowed by them because both of her parents are extremely bright and talented scientists. Her father works for the government in a secret scientific project and has been missing for several months. She has a younger brother whose name is Charles Wallace, and he's also different, and it takes a while to, as you go through the book, to really get a sense of what makes him special and different. That's something that they tease you with slowly. Because her father has disappeared, obviously this is a crisis in the family. They don't know what's happened to him, whether he's coming back or when. And because this is a fantasy, at some point in the town that they live in, a trio of elderly women called Mrs. What's-It, Mrs. Who, and Mrs. Which arrive. And when that happens, the children know something's about to happen. So Margaret and Charles Wallace, her little brother, and Calvin, who is another boy who's a bit of a misfit. He's more outgoing, but he still doesn't quite fit in, and befriends them. The three of them go and embark on a quest to see if they can find Meg's father. And they do this with the help of the three mysterious women. I won't tell you what makes those women even more mysterious than they seem at first. You'll find that out as you read the book. So in the course of their adventure, they travel to places and, in fact, planets. This is science fiction that are amazing, terrifying, and in the hopes of finding their father. The thing I find amazing about Wrinkle in Time, and I think why it still continues to be so powerful, is that, particularly for the time that it was written, it deals with really deep issues of good and evil, authoritarianism, conformity, in a way that was far beyond its time, particularly writing for this age group at that time. So that's why I think it still really resonates today. L'Engle was a devout Episcopalian on the liberal end of the spectrum, and you can see a lot of that writing in her books. And this is actually the first of a trilogy. It's followed by A Wind in the Door, and finally by A Swiftly Tilting Planet, where the same characters continue on dealing with other adventures. So that's A Wrinkle in Time by Madeline L'Engle.
And do you have read-alikes for that?
I do. She's kind of hard for that because this is really a very distinctive story that's hard to duplicate. But I would say for for more classic literature, people like John Christopher and Ursula Le Guin, mm. who wrote similar kinds of sci-fi fantasy stories that are, I think, very accessible for people who don't think of themselves as sci-fi or fantasy readers.
Right.
But more recently, I think you might even find people like Neil Gaiman or the Divergent or Hunger Games series would appeal to similar kinds of people. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I think next up is Karen, and you're doing something a little different this year, right?
This time I'm coming up, a little bit different. I'll be popping up throughout with slightly shorter offerings, because my goal today is to remind you all of the wide variety of genres and subject matter and artwork that are in our graphic novel collection. So I kind of have a tasting from that menu today of recent graphic novels. And we're going to start with an appetizer of short romances, move on to a second course of Apache Warriors, and savor a moving and funny story of life with Alzheimer's, if that seems even possible. And we're going to finish up with a dessert that's kind of too complex and fabulous for me to even start to describe here. So I just want to remind everybody that these are definitely for older teens and adults, not for children. And so the first one I have today is called Fresh Romance, and it's a collection of romance stories. They were originally published online, but now they're in print, and they're definitely not your mother's romance. There's not a penniless but feisty heiress anywhere. there's no arrogant dukes. They're juicy bits, definitely, and you don't have to wait all the way to the end for them like you do in a Harlequin. So there's quite a variety in this. There's a clandestine high school romance. There's an 18th century tale of an arranged marriage that starts under a cloud. There's a reworking of Beauty and the Beast. And there's even a story starring a supernatural cafe waitress who likes to meddle in people's love lives. There's kind of a modern simplicity to all the artwork in the book, and the art, but the color palettes kind of vary with the subject, with the different stories. So I can show you here we have, this is the clandestine high school romance, and then you can see this is the cover from the 18th century one, which looks a little Jane Austen-y and has all the green tones. And then there's also the supernatural cafe waitress, which is one of my favorites. So there's something here for everyone. There is a little bit of explicit nudity in one of the stories, just to let you know. But if you're looking for the kind of feel-good vibe of romance with a modern twist, this is the perfect winter warmer for you. So yes. I think you're next, Beth.
Okay. I was inspired in my book choices this year by two winners of the Ig Nobel Prizes. And I'm not saying that incorrectly. It's Ig Nobel, I-G-N-O-B-E-L. And it's a parody of the Nobel Prizes. They're bestowed upon people whose research makes people laugh and then think. And although it can make people laugh, it can be quite serious research. So, for example, there was one that did a study of a particular mosquito that was a carrier of malaria. And they found out that these mosquitoes are as attracted to stinky feet as to stinky Limburger cheese. So they baited some traps in strategic points in Africa with Limburger cheese to try to catch these mosquitoes. So the Ig Nobel Prizes are given out, they're bestowed on people by an organization called that runs a humor magazine called the Annals of Improbable Research. And the hope is to spur people's pure curiosity, to have them raise questions about what's important and what's not, what's real and what's not, in science and everywhere else. So this year, two of the awards went to men who tried to become other animals, literally, and then wrote books about the experience. So I'm going to tell you about Goat Man, how I took a holiday from being human. But the other one is on the list. It's Charles Foster's Being a Beast. So my list is about the nature-human connection taken to a different level. And there are certain similarities to Jackie's about a connection to changing perspective, using nature to nurture, cultivate that change. So Goatman, he describes himself as a designer interested in, quote, technology, science, future research, etc., end quote. And there's going to be a lot of air quotes in mind. So his last project was 4 years ago, and it was the toaster project, and in which he tried to make a toaster from scratch. Now, I thought that meant getting sheets of steel. No. That meant going into the earth and getting iron ore to try to make this toaster. And it was a TED Talk, mm-hmm. so you can watch that on the TED Talks. So it's 4 years later. He's tired of trying to figure out what to do, and he wants to escape from real life and become a goat.
I'm sorry. How does he become a goat?
How does one become a goat?
He does so very methodically. He had originally wanted to be an elephant, so he's gotten a little more
practical. But elephant school was too expensive.
That's right. So he can't figure out what other animal to be, so he consults with a shaman, and they decide he has an affinity to goats. And so he systematically, the next step, is to figure out how to be a goat. So he has to figure out how to walk, how to eat, how to be with goats. So he does so working in conjunction with scientists and other experts.
Can you tell us something about what he finds out? I'd love to know.
Let me tell you about how he figures out how to eat. So he participates in an autopsy, and this book has a lot of pictures and photos, and he has photos of that autopsy. So if that's going to gross you out, just skip over those pages. But he does it hands-on. He participates in the autopsy and realizes that goats have four guts, mm-hmm. and they also have bacteria, protozoa, that help with the digestion of the grass that they graze on.
So like a cow chewing a cud.
Exactly. Yeah. But we don't have four. We just have the one stomach, and we don't have the right protozoa and microbes. So what he does is he fashions an extra stomach on his torso. He straps it in. He attaches a tube to it to get to his mouth, and he chews the grass. He grazes on the grass, spits it into the tube, which goes into the bag, dumps that at night into a pressure cooker, builds a little campfire, adds some hydrolyzed acid, lets it cook around. When it's done, he pours it into a cup, drinks it down. Oh. Yum, 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 that's his dinner.
I'm glad he did this so we don't have to.
Exactly.
Dedication.
So that's Goat Man, How I Took a Holiday from Being Human by Thomas Thwaites.
Wow.
Man, what's...
I don't know how I possibly can follow that, but I'm going to try. Everyone here knows that when I read for pleasure, I need a good character to intrigue me. And the book that I'm talking about today, Kelly Armstrong's City of the Lost, has a multitude of characters that do that. But most important is the main character, Casey Duncan, who is really a very strong protagonist and immediately had me envelop her, and I wanted to read more about her. She is a cop, but all the good things she does as a detective cannot erase the fact that she once killed a man before she earned her badge. I think that what she tries to do all the time is she's trying to do good. She's trying to make up for that terrible mistake that she made so early in her life. And her best friend Diana has this proclivity for getting into all sorts of problems with men especially, and she makes some very bad choices. So what Casey tries to do is she tries to make it better, and she always is interceding for her. Well, they get to a point where they're in so much trouble, they really don't have too many places to go with it. Their lives are threatened, there's no way out of the predicament they find themselves in, and they hear about this place. It's an invisible city in the Yukon called Rockton. And Rockton is totally off the grid. And they are actually allowed to go there, and they actually settle in. But Casey is very skeptical, because how can a city that's built on secrets be a safe place? Is it everything that it promises? Well, they are living off the grid. There's no mail, there's no internet, there's no telephone. There's no communication whatsoever with the outside world, and you can't go in and out unless you get permission from the town council. It's a very controlled environment. When they get to town, there's a couple of gruesome murders in a row, and they find out along the way that it isn't the first. Well, Casey becomes the sheriff's deputy, and Eric Dalton has been the sheriff for quite a while. He's a very young man, but he's lived there all his life. and he knows the town very well. And it's an odd town with odd people, obviously. But he's beginning to suspect that maybe the people there are not there for the right reasons. They're there to evade their, because they're being, you know, someone's trying to get them and prosecute them. But instead, they're saying that they're the victims of crimes. Mm-hmm. And he starts to feel, well, this isn't what's happening. He and Casey team together, and they try to figure it out. Mm-hmm. And this is what the whole premise of the book is based on, and it's fascinating. So Casey is soon plunged into the hunting of a killer in a town built on secrets. Now, Armstrong is very well known for her Otherworld series, and this is a little bit of a departure because that's all based on a female werewolf. Mm-hmm. However, this is a little bit different.
So what would you say are, like, the similarities and differences for people who are kind of used to her other series?
The very strong protagonist, obviously, and a female lead of sorts, because the female werewolf in the Otherworld series is the only one in the entire universe who's a female. And so she has obvious issues because of that. Mm. What Armstrong is really, really good at is building the tone and building the plot around a world, you know, that she's developed. Mm-hmm. Obviously, she makes a good premise here that there could be a place like Rockton somewhere. You believe that this is a possibility, but you have to do it with a leap of faith. She makes the circumstances ring true. But what she also does is she builds this very isolated community, and it makes it a very eerie tone. So it's a little spooky, and that's sort of what is in common with her other series.
Like, even though it isn't a specifically supernatural story, it still has the...
The atmosphere building makes
you feel
absolutely
the world building.
Yes, and the world building. So it's you know, the combination thereof. So she does a really good job of that.
Is there a lot of violence on the page?
You know, it's no gratuitous violence. A lot of times, what you're finding is the actual bodies, and she spares you no. It's a graphic description, but it isn't over the board. I mean, it really, she explains what happens, and it all plays into the plot. So she's not, but you don't actually... Mm-hmm. I have to tell you, what was scarier than the violence, and I have a pretty high tolerance for that, is the tone, because it's spooky. And that might bother people more, because it's a little bit bridging on horror.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's really a blood-soaked, locked-room mystery on steroids. That's how I like to describe it. And, you know, you should be prepared for an all-nighter to finish it. And I'm personally really excited because her second book in the series is coming out the 7th of February, and it's called A Darkness Absolute.
That's exciting.
Yes. So, Karen, why don't you tell us about another graphic novel?
Okay. The next book that I'm going to talk about is a beautiful book by the actor and the author Ethan Hawke, whose name you will all recognize, and the illustrator Greg Ruth. And it's called Inda, A Story of the Apache Wars. The author created, this is a piece of historical fiction, but they created it to kind of redress an imbalance in the standard telling that we all got in school of the, or maybe didn't get at all, of the Apache Wars. You've all heard, you know, the names of Cochise and Geronimo, but you might be a little vague on the details, and kind of mostly what people think about the Apaches is, oh, they're those really violent bad guys in the Old West movies. That's the general thought. So Inda, which is this beautifully illustrated in sepia-toned ink drawings, is... trying to tell the story from the inside of a people whose very existence is threatened and what that does to them. You can see we've got some illustrations here of this is a cover photo, and you can see some of the detail and also the violence that is expressed in this. Obviously, it's going to have violence, and then a sort of a comic book style that is more frames to tell the actual story. You get a mixture of this sort of the frames and then full page drawings as well. As Hawke says in the afterword to the book, he felt that this was a story that needed to be told again and again until the names of Geronimo and Cochise are as familiar to young American ears as Washington and Lincoln. I knew, he says, that it was not really my story to tell, but my heart felt compelled to tell it. So obviously this is a great one for history buffs, especially people who love the American West. And it even has a bibliography for further reading, because as most of the reviewers who read this said, it's a book that just makes you want to know more about all of this. So this is Inda, A Story of the Apache Wars by Hawke and Ruth.
And a really great example of how graphic novels can tackle very serious subjects.
Yes, absolutely. All righty. So next, we have Jackie again.
Me again. Okay. More nonfiction. So my second book today is called Presence, Bringing Your Boldest Self to Your Biggest Challenges by Amy Cuddy. And she is a Harvard professor and social psychologist. And she, with my first book, this was also a TED Talk. This was actually, at the time of me writing this, the second most watched TED Talk ever. So 27 million people saw it, so just a few.
Just a few.
Yeah.
More than watch yeah. this broadcast.
And it's popular for a reason. Literally everyone on the planet can find an application for her techniques. So, but I think it's important to back up and explain what she means by presence. What she says is, presence as I mean it throughout these pages is the state of feeling connected with our own thoughts, values, abilities, and emotions so that we can better connect with the thoughts, values, abilities, and emotions of others. It's kind of a mouthful. What she's saying here is she's talking about presence in the sense of being in the moment, not in the sense of when you would say someone has presence, like she came in and sort of took over the room with her aura. But it's really talking about being in the moment. It's very much in keeping with this sort of trendy idea of mindfulness right now. Everybody's kind of, you know, not looking ahead, not looking back, but really being in the moment. So that's what she means there. And there's a lot that goes into achieving that. It's harder than it sounds. But she does a really remarkable job of breaking down how you can achieve that. And she draws heavily on her own experiences, which is part of what makes this really interesting. She was in a horrific car accident when she was in college and suffered a traumatic brain injury to the point where they didn't know if she was ever going to be able to finish college. And she obviously went on to get a doctorate. She teaches at Harvard, so she's done okay. but she also draws on the stories of just regular people going about their lives and facing their own challenges. She talks about how you can employ these really simple techniques and they can have a really big impact on. And she's teaching you how to essentially act from a place of authenticity, ultimately from a place of personal power instead of fear. So her most well-known technique, which I love, is adopting a power position before you go into a challenging situation, be that a job interview or a presentation or, I don't know, being on WCAT. So I will actually demonstrate this. This is called the Wonder Woman or the Starfish. And studies have shown that adopting this position for a few minutes, either by yourself or while looking in a mirror, or as we did it before in a group, really opens you up to the world and in turn opens others up to you. And there's a lot of variations on this. And they've actually proven that just envisioning yourself in this position can really be helpful. They did a study with quadriplegic people who actually physically can't get into this position. And they pictured themselves doing it and really found that it still made a difference just in their minds. So like other books on my list, Perspective is really about giving the reader a new, Presence, rather, is about giving readers a new perspective. It's a different way of thinking about your relationship between your mind and your body. And honestly, just reading this book made me feel more confident and a little bit more in control. I did the starfish before this talk, as we all did. So really, it's truly worth the read, I think. Just like grit, everybody can have find an application for it in their lives.
Well, that's actually going to be my question for you. I mean, when I look at something like that, I'll think, well, you know, that might be applicable to someone who's a little younger than I am, who's had different life experiences. So would you say that this would appeal to a variety of people?
It would. I think if you were, say, dealing with a parent who was ill and in the hospital, and you had to act as their advocate, and you were talking to the doctor, a lot of people might feel like they're not in the position of power in that case. The doctor's really in control. So you might do this before you have to have an important talk with the doctor so that you feel like you're, you know, bringing your best self and you're asking the right questions.
Yeah.
It's not really about improving your performance so much as feeling as if you did your best and you can walk away being satisfied.
And again, authenticity is so important.
Authenticity.
Yeah. No, it's...
Yeah, so I really think everyone can find a place for it. Everyone's going to interview for a job at some point, probably. So.
Oh, yes, that's true. Thank you.
All right. So, again, that was Amy Cuddy's Presence, Bringing Your Boldest Self to Your Biggest Challenges.
And I think we're back to Jeff.
We are. My second book is another one that I reread, childhood favorite, from the mixed up files of Mrs. Basile Frankweiler.
My favorite.
By E.L. Konigsberg. It was published in 1967, and like A Wrinkle in Time, it also won the Newbery Award. And in fact, even more so than that, it is ranked on many best of lists of the 20th century as one of the most popular and beloved children's books of the entire 20th century. And I was surprised how much it's from the 60s. It has a feel of that. There's a certain datedness to it. But I was amazed at how rereading it as an adult, it really had just as much impact as it did when I read it as a child. As with many books like this for kids, one of the key aspects of it is that it's based on child protagonists who go off on some kind of adventure without adults to guide them, because that helps them to make their own choices, make their own mistakes, and learn along the way. Claudia Kincaid, who, like Meg in Wrinkle in Time, is about 13 years old, and she also is a bit of a misfit. She feels very underappreciated by her family. She lives in suburban Greenwich, Connecticut, and she decides to run away. So she goes through an elaborate plan of figuring out how this is. She's very methodical. How is she going to do this?
Like Goatman,
yeah. And one thing that she decides, which is turns out to be a very good idea, is to enlist her brother, her younger brother, Jamie, who probably the main thing he brings to this is that he's been diligently saving his allowance for quite some time and has amassed the revenue that they can use to go off and do this project. But more importantly, one of the things that she really thinks about is she doesn't really just want to run away. She wants to run to something, which I think is actually a pretty self-aware thing for a child her age to do. And so she decides that they're going to run to the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. So they do. They take their money and their plans, and they go off to New York, and they spend the day in the museum, and then when it closes down at night, they sleep in the museum. They sleep in a giant bed in one of the historic furniture displays. They bathe in the, I don't know if any of you remember the museum, but there's a big restaurant that, I don't think it's there anymore, but it used to have a big kind of pool and fountain in the middle. So they bathe in the fountain, and people throw coins in the fountain, so they collect the coins, and then during the day go out and buy food. So it's a very well thought out plan for a 13-year-old. But the crux of the story is that while they're there, a new exhibit opens at the museum, which is that they get a donation of a very small Renaissance sculpture of an angel, which is believed to possibly be a lost Michelangelo. And so it causes a big to-do in the city and in the press. So Claudia and her brother now have a mystery to solve. So is it really a Michelangelo? How could they figure that out and prove it one way or the other? And who's this mysterious Mrs. Basile Frankweiler of the title? She's the person who donated this to the museum for a tiny amount of money, like $200, for something that could potentially be a priceless work of art. So Claudia needs to know the answer, and they embark on an investigation to see if they can figure it out. And as is often the case in stories like this, they find that the pursuit of the answer is actually almost more worthwhile and more rewarding than finding the answer at the end. Mrs. Frankweiler, of course, becomes a very important figure in the story towards the end. The kids do meet her, and her mixed-up files of the title are an important part of how they go about their investigation to determine whether the statue is actually real or not. And Mrs. Frankweiler is also a very important sort of archetypal character for this kind of children's book, because she's that wise adult figure who is not a parent. So therefore, they can have a relationship with her and learn from her and take her advice more as a peer than as an adult. So it establishes a different kind of relationship. I think you'll never really visit a museum in quite the same way again after reading this.
I believe that's based on a true story.
It kind of is, yes. At the time, this is back in the 60s. At the time this was written, the Metropolitan did receive a donation for a very tiny amount of money for a Renaissance sculpture, much like the one in the story. It did not turn out to be a Michelangelo, but it was still a big thing in the news at the time. And although it's not that the story itself is true, but it's an interesting sort of background tidbit to the author, is that Königsberg was, much of this is autobiographical. She lived in the New York area, was raising her children, and she was taking art classes in New York. So she would take the train into New York, take her kids with her, and while she was doing her art class, she would drop the kids off at the museum and they could explore and see the art.
All of them? All of them.
And she would pick them up on the way home, and they explored the museum and learned about art. And one day when she picked them up, she happened to notice the kind of thing that, you know, only an author would see, these little details. They were looking at an exhibit and noticed that there was some popcorn behind, like in the exhibit behind where people were allowed to go. Mm-hmm. And so that got her thinking of what kind of situation could possibly have brought that about. Mm-hmm. And so she took that tiny little kernel, if you'll pardon the pun, and turned it into a story that ended up being one of the most, you know, cherished stories of the 20th century. So that's from the mixed up files of Mrs. Basil E. Frankweiler by E.L. Königsberg.
Great. That's amazing. Thank you. Really quick, lightning round. What was your favorite childhood book?
Oh, well, that was one of them, but the other one would probably be Charlotte's Web by E.B. White.
Mm. Okay.
Phantom Tollbooth. I don't know who the author is.
Norton Juster.
Okay, yep.
The Westing Game by Ellen Raskin. Mm-hmm.
And mine is actually Wind in the Willows by Kenneth Graham, as well as the E.B. White. And
all of which are on my list.
Uh-huh. Here we go. There we go. Excellent.
Perfect.
So why don't you give us another taste?
Okay, another taste. This is a startlingly lovely book called Alzheimer's Through the Looking Glass. And it's a biography both of a mother-daughter relationship, but also of the disease of Alzheimer's itself. So the author is Dana Walrath, and her elderly mother, Alice, who's this beautiful Armenian woman, comes to live with her when she can no longer take care of herself. So the book's title is a play on both Alice's name and the kind of surreal experience that you going through the looking glass into the world of Alzheimer's. So Walrath uses quotations from Alice in Wonderland itself mixed in with her text. And she also even uses the text itself to create her artwork for the book. You can see in this one, that she's wearing a dress as she remembers her husband in years past. She's wearing a dress that is made out of Alice in Wonderland text, and this she wears through the book. One of the points of this book, which is in a series called Graphic Medicine, is to show Alzheimer's patients as something other than the scary kind of brainless zombies that we tend to make them out to be. The author says in her introduction that she has set out to reframe dementia as a different way of being, as a window into another reality that lets people living in that state be our teachers, useful, true humans who contribute to our collective good. And this book definitely does all of that and more. It'll really surprise you. She portrays her time with Alice as this time of healing and magic and even humor, as this other picture will show you. Alice is very focused on food. She wants to eat all the time. But she only wants to eat what she wants to eat. And she's never liked dogs in her life, but she's managed to form this alliance with Herbie, the family dog. And so you can see in this picture here, she's saying, "Dana, Herbie ate my lunch. Do you have any ice cream? Because she always wants ice cream." So, you know, there's just these little glimpses into the humor of the situation, which come more frequently than you would think. So the book is Alzheimer's Through the Looking Glass by Dana Walrath.
Karen, I want to ask you a question. It's part of a series, so there are other books that...
Yes, there are other books that deal with other diseases in this series called Graphic Medicine.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you.
I think Beth's turn.
Yes, you are next, Beth.
Okay. So my second nature human book is not about animals this time. It's about trees. And it's not about anybody trying to be a tree, although that may come in the near future. But it's about the wood wide web. The Hidden Life of Trees by Peter Volleben he describes how trees feel, how they communicate, and how they help each other through life. An example of the wood wide web is how an entire forest can communicate with the trees all in the forest can communicate using the fungus growing on their root tips. They send out chemical signals. It's a fascinating book in which he has gathered research from scientists around the world and from his own work working in German forests for over 15 years. You can feel his awe and his love of the trees in his writing. He discusses how trees are both individual and social beings, how they nurse their sick, how they lavish love and attention and restrictions on their children, and even take care of their dead.
It sounds almost, I actually read this as well and loved it too, but it's almost like he's kind of anthropomorphizing.
Absolutely. As you can tell from the paragraph where he's just that I read about talking about his children and caring for them. But he pulls it off because he sticks with the scientific research and he uses it to explain complex biological problems. And he makes it thoroughly enjoyable by doing that. And as the Washington Post reviewer said, frankly, right now, nature needs every little bit of help it can get. So if Volleben's decision to anthropomorphize nature gets more than 500,000 Germans to care about forests and ancient forests, I do hope he can do the same for Americans. So that's The Hidden Life of Trees by Peter
Volleben.
Leanne, what's your second book?
Who tells your story? This has been a very resonating question that has been very popular this past year because of Hamilton, which is the Broadway musical. And Ann Patchett has written a book called Commonwealth, and this plays, that question, who tells your story, plays a pivotal role in that novel. Patchett is known for a variety of books. Her Exotic Locales brought you to amazing places in Bel Canto and also in The State of Wonder. But here, she does something that's a bit closer to home. She traces the evolution of an American family in 5 decades. And you wouldn't think that would be very enthralling, but it truly is. Her 7th novel opens with a door opening into this very small house. And there's a bunch of people there. And Fix Keating has expected all of them. Most of them are cops and their wives, because they're all there to celebrate Franny, his youngest's, christening. And when the door opens and he looks over, he sees Bert Cousins, a near stranger, and he says to himself, what is he doing here? He's standing there on the threshold carrying a very large bottle of gin, which, of course, is very welcome. But when Bert meets Fix's incredibly beautiful wife, Beverly, there is a tectonic shift in both households. Bert is married. He has 3 kids with 1 on the way. And what happens because of their meeting changes everybody's life. And the whole, it's really about the repercussions of the breaking asunder and putting back together again of this family. The 6 children grow up together and almost like a pack of feral wolves, or feral dogs, I should say, is how Patchett puts it. And she does a really wonderful job of evoking how difficult this is, but also how amazing it is when you get to choose who's in your family and how that works. I would have to say that it goes back and forth over and over again to who tells your story, predominantly because Franny gets involved with the novelist, and there's some repercussions from that, and the kids, as they grow up and live their own lives, hear their own story in a way they never thought they would, and that causes quite a few problems.
This sounds like one of those books that would be hard to sort of classify.
Yes.
And particularly because she always writes something a little bit different. Who would this particular one appeal to, do you think?
Well, I think if you love to read about characters and their choices, this is a really good book for you, because that's really what's happening throughout the entire novel. But also, she does something about the way she weaves place and detail is really, she just has an amazing way with her words. And I think that it will appeal to people who like place and setting as part of the characters. And you know, like I felt the trickle of perspiration as I read that first chapter about, you know, in that little Los Angeles house in the summer. But also the way she uses oranges as both metaphor and as the physical orange is very, very, well, it's just ingenious. And you smell and taste them throughout the entire novel. You think to yourself, this is just a simple story about two families, but she does so much more with that. She makes it into a universal story with a lot of universal themes about how really people grow and how you develop into who you are because of the human beings you are bred with, even if they aren't someone that were born to your own mother and father. Mm-hmm. She does a wonderful job with that. What is difficult about this is that it is told with constant shifts in point of view. So if you're someone who needs, you know, more linear stories, you're going to have to be patient with it, but it's well worth that. There's a peripatetic chronology, I mean, and she jumps in, and all of a sudden there's more and more characters being added to the pages.
Wait, so is it actually different perspectives? I mean, are you actually getting it told from different perspectives, or is
it's a third-person point of view, so it's an omniscient author, but it really feels like a variety of unreliable narrators, which is one of the reasons, of course, why I enjoyed this so much. But this was a wonderful surprise for me, because I knew that Patchett would always write a very good novel, but I had no idea it would rise to the top of my list, because it was just such a stellar effort of writing. And a wonderful experience. She captures the absurdity and the heartbreak of domestic life in a way that I very rarely get to read. Mm. So it was a lot of fun as well. So I think we have a final
one.
Our dessert, I believe.
Dessert.
Yes.
Dessert is another collection of stories. Well, called Flashed: Sudden Stories in Comics and Prose. And the first thing you have to know. Is where the title Flash comes from, and it comes from the idea of flash fiction. And flash fiction is really, really short fiction, like somewhere between 200 and 1,000 words, so not even your average sort of short story, much shorter. And so it's the idea of flash, it's a little bit like a game of telephone. It's the editors started by commissioning, for instance, a comic artist. And the comic artist was asked to draw a comic on a subject of their choosing. And then the editors took it and passed it on to the second person in the game of telephone. And the second person was an author. And the author has to react to the first piece, to the comic, and riffs on it in whatever way he or she feels like doing. And then that piece, the piece of writing, is then passed on to a third artist, in this case another comic artist, who hasn't seen the first one, only the second one, and riffs on it in their own way. So what you end up with is this triptych, as the editors call it, a group of three, which acts as one. And they are sometimes really closely related, because they are, or they're not. Just a tiny little thread will kind of run through the three of them. And then what you get at the end is the contributors actually commenting, like reading over through the whole group and commenting on what they thought of the whole triptych, which is really interesting. That's actually one of the most interesting parts of it, to see whether they liked it or didn't like it, and they're pretty frank. And speaking of contributors, there are some really great ones in this book, including Juno Diaz, Steve Almond, Amy Bender, and Carol Lay. So the variety of artwork styles is huge. I'm not even going to try to give you a sampling, because they're all so different. But it's not a straight-up graphic work. If that's what you're looking for, that's not what you're going to get here. But if you're looking for sort of a grab bag of short, snappy, and surprising, then Flash is a very rewarding choice.
Great. Thank you. What I didn't say in the beginning of this is that we are available at www.wakefieldlibrary.org, and you can find any of the lists that we've been talking about there. There's also a wonderful display set up right now with the lists, and you can always get the lists on our website after that is over. So we invite you all to come down to do that. But before we sign off, I want to quickly go around the room and the chairs and just talk a little bit about, really quickly, about your list and maybe one of the books that you didn't have a chance to talk about. Karen.
Mine that I'd like to talk about is called The Attack. I believe the author is Duvalier, but I might be getting that wrong. And it's a very hard-hitting account of a Palestinian doctor living in Israel who finds out that his wife may be the suicide bomber in an attack that has just happened. And it's his desperate search for the truth. And it's very enlightening on the whole Palestinian-Israeli situation, and it's obviously quite graphic as well. But a really beautifully done, hard-hitting piece of work.
Good, thank you. Beth?
I'd like to mention Charles Foster's Being a Beast, which I mentioned earlier. It's a little bit like Goatman in that he's trying to be four animals. And one of the ones he chooses is a badger. So he snuffles out a den for himself, and he goes in with his 8-year-old son, and then he's snuffling to get food, grubs in the ground.
They're blindfolded, right?
Yeah, they are at certain points. Yeah.
I'm glad my father never wanted to do that.
Well, he's a little different than Goatman in that he does try a grub, but he gets food from a farmer that's near the badger's den. But he's also different in that he goes off in flights of fantasy and philosophy. So it's a very different feel, but also kind of fascinating.
Fascinating is one word for that. Jackie.
I would point out one from my list called Modern Romance by Aziz Ansari. He's, you might know him, he's a comedian. He was on Parks and Recreation, on the show, for a long time. He's very funny, and it's a surprisingly well-researched book. While it's humorous and light, he actually worked with a sociologist to compile all of this data about how people find love and how it's changed over the years. How people date now, and how the dynamic has shifted, and how technology plays into it. It's fascinating. He's about my age, and I'm not that far out of the game. I've not been married that long, but it's even in the short time. It's completely changed, and how it's changed since the 50s, and how he delves in a little bit to arranged marriage and things like that. It's really interesting. It's a great listen. Also, he reads it himself. Mm. And because he's a comedian, he does it really well. He ad-libs a little bit on the audio. So well worth the listen or the read. No.
I actually listened to that as a palate cleanser between some serious books I had to read for book discussions. And I laughed so hard. But I also learned things I never wanted to know.
Yep.
and hope I never need to use. So anyway, that was very interesting, though. Yeah, it was very funny. And he does a great job on it. Jeff?
I'm going to talk about one that Beth mentioned earlier, The Phantom Toll Booth.
Oh, right.
It's a little different from some of the other ones on my list, but I love it because it's so quirky and so different. It's about Milo is, another little kid who he gets a mysterious toll booth that appears as a gift, and he drives through it in his little toy car and ends up in a fantasy world. It's not really a fantasy in the traditional sense. It's actually a book all about wordplay, and so I think people who enjoy word games, puzzles, that kind of thing, it takes a very literal look at different examples of the way we talk about words, and it's unique, it's hard to describe, but it's a lot of fun.
Oh, good. As everybody here is bored to tears knowing, I developed two lists at the end of the year. One is on adrenaline, which is mysteries and thrillers and suspense. And one of the books on that list was a sleeper. And I call it a sleeper because I don't know why I didn't hear about it. It came out in like 2011. And I have this fascination, as you also know, with assassins. And the book is called The Assassin by Tom Wood. And it was a great series. If it's you want the action-packed stuff that Lee Child, writes, which is just unbelievable pace and will a lot of action. And what I liked about Wood's style is that he does give his assassin a conscience, and sometimes these books don't do that. So I thought it was very well done. And I've only read the first one in the series, but I of course have the rest of them on my to-do list when I ever have leisure time again. So that was one of the books that surprised me. The other book on
so is that sort of like Dexter?
No, because Dexter, you mean the Lindsay book? No. Dexter has a lot of pace to it that is very, very similar, but you don't get the kind of gore that you get in Dexter, even though he's an assassin. He just, it's not the same thing. The other book I wanted to mention was a fantasy, and it's by Genevieve Cogman, and it's called The Invisible Library. And as a librarian, I loved it, because it's about this woman who is a librarian, and she jumps in time, and she has to retrieve these wonderful objects out there that are books or parchments or something, and there's always a reason for it. And because she jumps in time, she's back, you know, in Shakespearean England, and she's here and there all over the place. And, of course, there are other rogue librarians who are after her. It was a wonderful, wonderful hoot. It was a lot of fun. It was great fantasy, great world building, terrific characters. And her apprentice in this particular adventure, and I believe it goes on for the rest of the series, I haven't had a chance to get to those either. The second one is called The Masked City. He is a dragon. And it's
dragons.
Very interesting how Cogman, he does many things. Cogman has a great way of explaining this character and giving it real wings, if I may say so. So anyway, those were some wonderful things on my list. The other thing I just want to quickly say is that my favorite book last year was Anthony Doerr's All the Light You Cannot See. There is a reason why everybody is talking about this book. It is stunning, and if you haven't read it, I really encourage you to pick it up. It makes a great book discussion book.
It's still on the bestseller list.
Yeah, it's still on the bestseller
list. Definitely second that recommendation.
I totally agree.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Third. Exactly. Yep. So anyway, thank you for joining me today, and thank you for viewing us, and we look forward to seeing you at the library. Remember, if you want a personal suggestion list of your favorite of your next reads, come to us with what you've read before, what you're looking for now, and we will try to match you with that next great book. So thank you very much.